you've all seen this. I don't going to talk about it. Everyone shows this type of picture. But we see a lot of things happening here in this area. So we think it is really important to understand that even in professional use cases like we are working in, automotive, industrial, we see a lot of things happening in this area, connecting things to the internet in different ways. I mean, in industrial, it could be things like connecting a machine to a local type of internet service, but not doesn't have to be a fancy service somewhere in the cloud. But this thing is happening all over the place. So we really see this happening now. And as a company making modules like this, of course, we think that it could be very important for us, as you can understand. But one problem we see is down here on the last 100 meters connectivity, there's a lot of different technologies. There's many, many different. It's not one, but many, many ways of connecting, doing the same thing. You can connect using different wireless technologies, different wire technologies. There's a lot of different acronyms that is used in this area. And that makes it rather complicated for a company like ours, for example. What connectivity technology should we use for the last 100 meters connectivity? So that's one area. But of course, on a more wider range, I mean, the phone networks, the GSM, the LTE, the cellular networks are, of course, rather common. So that's not that, but in this last 100 meters connectivity, we really see a big challenge for a company like ours. So our vision is to be one of the leading industry quality supplier of communications and positioning components for Internet of Things that really matters. We want to stress things. It's the thing that really matters in our case. For example, if you connect an industrial machine or industrial device to the internet, there are some extra requirements on security, on reliability, on robustness, and things like that you need to take care of. So that's what we want to be good at. And that's the reason why I want to talk about this. There are some specific challenges in this area that is very important. And I see it also goes into other areas, if you think about it a little bit more. So we focus on typically business-critical applications like connected vehicles, like the connected city, like the connected industry. And the requirements we have is, of course, they should run 24/7. Always. They should be exceptionally reliable, and they should handle, if there are some problems, they should handle them in a good way. Should be able to track them, should be able to handle the exceptions in a good way, so that we minimize disruption on the service and whatever you need to do with your connectivity. And that's a special challenge we are facing in this area. We always show a drawing like this. This is what we work with. We actually connect sensors all the way through gateways to the internet. We don't do the cloud services. We do the infrastructure. We want to make an infrastructure that makes it possible to do this. And that could be using short-range technologies like Bluetooth or Wi-Fi to a gateway to the internet. It could also be connecting a device directly via cellular to the internet. Could be connected cars. Now you had this topic a while ago here on this forum. That's very important for us, this connected car. People talk about V2V and V2I today. Connect between cars and connect a car to the internet. It's a big thing coming. In a couple of years from now, you probably will see cars are more and more autonomously driving. And then, of course, connectivity is very important in that respect. But that is also combined with things like position and time in our area. It's very important that if you can combine data with position and time, you can get extra benefits. So I'm going to talk a little bit about this as well. Short range and gateways, yes. This is a specific area. In many cases, you have small sensors that you want to connect to the internet in some way. And they use technologies like Bluetooth Low Energy or Wi-Fi or maybe 802.15.4, Zigbee or whatever. But they, of course, they need to be connected through a gateway. So that's another use case that's very important for this type of scenarios is when you have mobile gateways. And the phone is typically a mobile gateway in many cases. So that you could connect many applications you see today that is actually Internet of Things applications are using the phone as the gateway. Maybe most of them probably today as well. So you have a sensor that you connect to the phone, and then the phone connects it to the internet in some way. So this is also a very important scenario in this respect. So this is local connectivity using gateways connect to the internet. But cellular is very common too. So in many cases, and you will also connect a cellular or some device, for example, a meter, or typically a metering system. Many of you have electrical meters at home that's connected directly to the internet using a cellular connection, some kind of modem, some kind of GSM modem or whatever that connects directly to the internet. But also the car, if you have a connected car today, it's typically connected directly to the internet via cellular modem, of course. And then V2X is for us a very specific use case. I will talk a little bit more about this. For us, this is become more and more important. Is because if you have a modern traffic system, the cars must be connected to each other much, much more than it has done before. For example, talk to each other in different ways. If you drive two cars very close to each other, if they could talk to each other, of course, then you could align the cars better and get better traffic system, less congestions and things like that. So this is a common area that comes a lot. What's also important is to talk directly to the infrastructure. For example, talk to the traffic signs, things like that. Talk to the, know about what's happening beside the road. Talk to the pedestrians. Could be a lot of things that we are working with currently. And here you have special technologies coming up. There are special variants of Wi-Fi, for example, for this, called 802.11p. Specific, robust type of Wi-Fi that is used for car-to-car communication, for example. So this is another important area for this robust networking concepts. And there are many key short-range technologies, of course, for this. One is Wi-Fi still. Wi-Fi is a lot used, especially if we need high speed and local connectivity, but still local connectivity, but high speed. What we've been working a lot with is Bluetooth Low Energy. It's when you have one to few. You don't have a complete big network. You have only a few nodes you want to connect. With periodic transfer of small amounts of data. Low power, typically very low power in this case. Short setup times. But what is happening now with Bluetooth Low Energy, and that you should know, that this will change a lot in the future. So they add long range and mesh technology to Bluetooth as well. So it will be possible to use Bluetooth Low Energy for other things, like more wide range type of things. And the most important thing for us about Bluetooth Low Energy in this respect is that it supports the phone ecosystem. Because of the phone ecosystem, you actually have the phone could be part of the same network as the Bluetooth Low Energy net, the rest of the sensors are. And that's very important for the success of that technology, I think. If you compare with 15.4, that we also use a lot, the Sigbian different, there's one called Thread, that's Google behind that one. And so because of that, it will be very important. That's a mesh technology, typically. Also small amounts of data, lower power, and that's 2.4 gigahertz, and it's also sub-gigahertz, it's other frequency bands. And this will also be important, but compared to Bluetooth Low Energy, it has its own ecosystem. For use cases where it's okay to have their own ecosystem, it works very well and will be very much used in the future as well. We will see what happens here, but I think there will be some kind of collision here because Bluetooth is moving to the same type of use cases as this technology is in the future. We will see what happens. We are working with both, just to be sure. Another thing that's happening that's kind of interesting is that cellular technology is diverging. You know, cellular typically move this way to more and more advanced video type of applications. But what now is happening is that it's moving in the other direction as well, towards even smaller, low power type of devices. And what we are specifically working on is what's called narrowband IoT. That's actually a cellular technology, more or less, but actually it's... We talk about nodes that should cost a few dollars to add to a device. Still using the same infrastructure. This is actually standardized. Standardized. It's not standardized yet, but there is a standardization work going on in the 3DPP consortium about this. So we think that will be very important for many technologies, for many use cases in IoT in the future as well. So don't forget about that, I think, because that will happen as well. So there will be lots of competing technologies that will work in this area. Now I will talk about this Internet of Things that really matter. And we talk about, we talk about four things. We talk about add where to the what. I will talk about bondment. Add when to the what. And secure the how and secure the what. You will understand better later on what we mean by that. I will start with this picture. And this shows what I mean by adding what and where to the when. Add where and when to the what, I mean. So the thing is that we will add position and time to the data. And for us in this type of scenarios with more robust network, this is very important. Because if you can add accurate time or accurate position to the data you collect in an Internet of Things scenario, that data becomes much more valuable than if you don't have that. So that's something that we work a lot on. So if we can combine like GPS technology with other technologies to get to this, then it will be very important for the future as we see it. And adding the where. And one thing, of course, is to use a GPS, a GNSS device is a GPS device, and connectivity. You could, of course, put a GPS device all the way down to the sensors, at least if you're outdoors. And that's sometimes what people are doing. You can also have a gateway that actually has the GNSS device, and then you need have a kind of a rough position for the rest of the devices. So that's one way of getting where to the what. But what also is happening, and we are working a lot on, is also different indoor positioning technologies. Say you have a known position of the gateway. If you can in some way use that known position to position the local devices, the sensors as well, then it can be very useful for us. And some standards are going on, is on its way to happen here. For example, in Bluetooth, beacons you all heard about already. That's actually some kind of primitive positioning technology used by Bluetooth. Just a Bluetooth device advertising is, I'm here, I'm at this position. Then you can use that beacons, of course, to calculate some rough position. But even more important, what's happening now is that in the Bluetooth standardization work, they are adding features that allows us to measure things like angle of arrival and departure. It's angle of the radio signal. And if you have that, you can calculate accurate positions. We talk about decimeter level of position for the device that's moving around. So if you have a phone moving in this room, for example, you can get down to decimeter level of precision of knowing what a phone is. And of course, that can get very useful information to connect to the data you connect. If you know where the device is at the same time as you retrieve some information from the device, that for sure is extra value to the data. Wi-Fi, the same thing. A lot of people are using fingerprinting today. Do you know fingerprinting? Fingerprinting is where you actually use kind of the pattern from different access points in Wi-Fi and understand where you are because using that patterns. There are lots of companies doing that. For example, there's a company called Combane in Lund doing this. It's where you actually use, you kind of learn yourself the different patterns of access points, and based on that you can calculate roughly at least where you are. And depending how much information you have, the more you can do. So that's something that already is happening a lot. And that's we are using that too, also outdoor. So if you can use patterns of known access points, you can get a rough position. And the phone is doing that as well, in some respect. But what also is happening is that there are some new time of flight measurements. So you can really get down to high precision. We talk about decimeter level there as well. You measure the time the radio signal moves in the air. And by using that, you can combine data again to the time, position, and data to the data you collect, and that will be part of the Wi-Fi standard as well, and that is happening now. So you will see chips that's coming out really soon that will support this. the other things that you can do, there's some other technologies. For example, ultra-wideband is one technology, a radio technology that you can use to get to a good position. These are not standardized today, but there are lots of companies working in that, so we are looking into that as well. That might be some standards coming up as well, but there's no one now. We can also use 802.15.4 technologies to measure time of flight and things like that. And there's lots of proprietary stuff for that as well. And cellular, you can use the same fingerprinting technology as you use for Wi-Fi, using the different cells you see, and based on those cells, calculate where you are, roughly. Depending on how good your database is, you can get down to tens of meters at least. Another thing that is happening is we need to add time to the data. Because if you have an accurate time on the data you collect, for sure the information is much more worth. So and of course you can use standard technologies like that's standard protocols called NTP and PTP to do this. But then you get kind of a rough time synchronization. You can also use the GPS device or the GNSS or the GPS device as a time source on a gateway. Of course, the GPS has a very accurate time. GPS can deliver time down to even nanosecond level if you have a good GPS. So you can get really good time on that. Then, of course, based on that, you can use time synchronization over the short-range network to synchronize even down to the sensors. And that's something that we're looking a lot into now that we think will be very important for the future, that you could synchronize the time, at least down to microsecond level. Because if you have a synchronized data point, say, for example, if you have an electrical distribution system and there is an error in the electrical distribution system, then there's some switch that falls down. And when one switch falls down, thousands of other switches automatically fall down because they are kind of connected to each other. If you can know which switch was the first one, then you can get a much more value of the data. And then you need time synchronization down to microseconds to do that. So this is one example where you can actually add value to the data by adding time. Accurate time. And the more accurate, the better. Security is another thing as well that we are looking into a lot. And there are lots of if you assume you have some kind of wireless module like this is a wireless module, and it has a CPU or MCU inside. And then there are a cloud service up here, and then there's a radio network here. And then there is a firmware, some software running in the module, for example, or in the device. And there are some interface connecting the device somewhere else. There's a lot of attack points here that is dangerous if you want to have safe data. And I will go through a little bit about this problem as I see it. One problem that probably is where everything starts, in my opinion, is that you really know that the thing that's running in your device is the thing you aim to run on the device. And how many systems really know that the right software is running in the device? That's nothing else has been kind of put into the device by some malicious, And so this is a very important feature that we think that a real Internet of Things device that is used for more advanced use cases must really have a secure boot of firmware, knowing that you actually boot the right software every time. So you know that someone else hasn't put their own software into the device. That's one thing. Another thing is, of course, in our case, that it works with radio, a secure radio link. You see a lot of radio links. If you kind of get out and scan for radio links, wherever you are in the world, you see a lot of radio links that are completely open. They are not secure at all. That's very common, actually, and much more common than you can believe. So this is one thing that we need to think about, of course, as well. Another thing is, okay, you can secure the radio link, but what actually people often want to have is some kind of authenticated and encrypted application all the way to the cloud. So inside the device here, where you actually collect the data, you want to kind of have a secure link all the way to the cloud, of course. That's what people normally mean by Internet of Things security, but that's only one part of Internet of Things security. The other things we talked about is also important, but this is, of course, what people normally mean by Internet of Things security, that you have a data point that you know it's this. This data point is coming from here and sent to this service up here. No one else can kind of get into it. But another thing that people normally often forget if you have a device is that there are other interfaces. Normally this device can talk to another interface. There are some kind of interface. Do you know that this is secure? In many cases, not. I mean, we have example for products that's using Ethernet as an interface to another interface. That interface is not secure. So people can actually do bad things over the host interface to the other device. And we that make modules like this, for example, we must make sure that if people connect to this device using some kind of external interface, we must make sure that we could, if the customer wants to at least, that we can have a reliable connection to this device. So we don't know that no one else can come in the middle and do something. Often forgotten in this area is that if you make a board, if you develop a board that you use for something, you want to debug the board. So you have some kind of port on the board so you can debug. You have some serial port or a debug port. And of course that port is a really dangerous point in security. So if someone can get into that, he can actually destroy the complete device or change the software in the device. So that should of course also be protected. And that's very often forgotten. Then the API as such, if you look in the real world, you have some kind of API, that application interface that connects from this device to this device. And in many cases, those interfaces are not secured. It means that, for example, it's not the same as the previous point, because in this case, we talk about, a good example is a radio module like this, for example. And if you have a radio module, that radio module might have special commands that is used to trim the module in production, for example, or have commands that makes it possible to tune the module and things like that. You see a lot of cases where you actually can get to those commands over the host interface. They're maybe not documented, but does that help? If you can get to the commands anyway, someone will do it. And some of you laugh and say, is this really the case? But in many cases, this is really the case. Those type of interfaces are really open in many cases. And that's really bad, of course. So if you have an interface, you should see to that you block out those API functionality that is not allowed for the customer to use. Another thing is spoofing and yamming. Do you know the difference between spoofing and yamming? And yamming is, of course, when you just have a radio world, if you have a wide band signal that just destroys everything that's in the air, more or less. And that, of course, is difficult to prohibit. If someone really wants to do that, if you fill this room with bad Wi-Fi signals all over the place, it's difficult for real Wi-Fi to get through, of course. But what is important for a company like us that makes Internet of Things that really matters is that to be able to detect that, so that we can warn upwards that now there is some problems that we need to handle. So that's something that we put a lot of work into as well, to find out, are we jammed or not? Spoofing is when you actually pretend you are someone else. You pretend you are a real part of the network. And of course, encryption of the Wi-Fi and things like that could prohibit that. But there are many use cases where that is not really done. So for example, one good thing is in Wi-Fi, lots of access points, they are not protected on the MAC layer, on the lower layers. So you can actually detach the device from the network by just spoofing it, a message, send a message in the air, and all the devices disconnect. Things like that is very common today. So of course, spoofing is important to protect. And in GPS that we also work in, it's something that is starting to become a real problem. That people actually pretend they are a GPS transmitter, a satellite. And actually you can fool the GPS that you are somewhere else in the world. That's really bad if you are flying UAV or something like that. So it's, and actually what people also are doing is using these type of devices to spoof. Say if you have an insurance box, and many, not so common here in Europe, but in the US it's very common that you have a box in your car that you pay, the insurance you pay is depending on how much you drive and where you drive and things like that. So if you can spoof the position where you are, you can get a lower insurance. And actually people do that. We have had cases like that. So it's rather common, these type of problems. Another thing is that we who make modules like this, we want to be able to put, we want allow people to put their own code in the module. So if people want to put their own code in this module, we want our customers to be able to do that because those modules are rather powerful. So in that case, of course, you need to make sure that this is done in a secure way. For example, separate the custom application from our own application. And that's also a regulatory thing because the Wi-Fi part, for example, is protected by regulatory rules. So you don't allow to do whatever you want with the Wi-Fi part and things like that. So this is very important to protect the application from the provider of the module from the application from the customer. And that's also very often if you use a simple system, development system, that could be maybe not at all done. And this also it means that you need to have secure interfaces to and from the application to the code that we deliver as a module manufacturer. And the reason why we say that we need to have a more advanced environment, and we're looking, for example, there is an environment developed by ARM now called Embed, that in the future at least will support this type of features, for example, so that you can actually separate your application from the standard application in the device in a real good way. And that is very important. And also separate, for example, security data from application data and things like that is very important. Yes, I think maybe I should show a little bit of demo as well, if I'm lucky. I have just want to show this scenario here. So actually it's good because it's kind of adds on to the next speaker, because what we do here, we have a Bluetooth low energy device running in a dice. Actually, looks like this. You can see it here. So I have a little Bluetooth node with a battery. And that actually is connected to a module like this. It's a gateway module. This module talks Bluetooth low energy to this. Then it talks Wi-Fi uplink and to a hotspot. And in my demo here, I'm using my phone as the hotspot. It connects to an IBM Bluemix server up here. And in that one, we have a kind of a small application using Node-RED that we're going to talk about a little bit more later on. And that actually exposes the data using a web socket to HTML5 app running in the cloud. So it's kind of a stupid demo, of course, because it's a dice, but it shows the whole link from a sensor up to the lens. And we actually can, I only have one dice here, but you can run it with several dices. We have a demo with six running, so we can actually roll the dice and then get the information up on the cloud. See if it works now. It should work. Yeah. So what we have here is this dice here. So the position of the dice, you can actually see if I roll it here. It should be a six. Yes, it will be six. So it goes all the way up to the cloud. So what actually the sensor values from the Bluetooth low energy device has an accelerometer on the device. Take this sensor value, sensor value of Bluetooth low energy to a gateway, and from that gateway up to the internet via Wi-Fi actually. So it shows what can be done with this type of scenarios. Any questions to me? I'm kind of finished now.
What's the lifetime of that battery?
Actually, what this actually does, as soon as it doesn't move anymore, it closes its connection and it gets into sleep mode. So, So depending a lot of how much you use it, of course. But I have had this battery now for several months. So probably in normal use case, Bluetooth energy you can get down to microamp level of power consumption. So we have use cases where we actually have sensors that have a coin cell battery and runs for 5-6 years, even 7-8 years in some cases. And that's what's possible today actually with modern low power technologies. In this case, it's about I think it's about 30-40 meters or something like this in this case. So it's depends on the antenna and as a wireless. The problem with Bluetooth, people say, I mean, Bluetooth is only 10 meters. Yes, to the phones. But if you connect a device with a good antenna, I mean, a phone is a compromise, will always be. Lots of antennas and lots of bad stuff in close to the antenna and things like that. So it will always be very small. So, but if you have a good antenna solution, you can get much longer range. We have Bluetooth low energy solutions with several hundred meters of range today, if you have a good antenna. So you can get much longer. Typically, I mean, the Bluetooth is a master-slave type of network. So you have one master and a bunch of slaves. So we say point to few points. That's typically what it's meant for. But what is happening now in the Bluetooth standardization, SIG as they call it, is that they are implementing a mesh technology on top of Bluetooth. And then, of course, you can have many hops. Then you can overcome the range. But what also is happening that they are adding higher sensitivity to Bluetooth by a new modulation technique. So you can really get about 8 to 10 dBm longer range. And that's a lot. That's several hundred meters longer. So there will be a standard called Bluetooth 5.0 soon. And that standard will support really long range, in my opinion. They will also allow a lot higher output power than they do today. So it's moving towards long range. And the reason for that is, of course, that Bluetooth low energy want to get into the Internet of Things. Today they are the most dominating technology for the personal area network around your as person. Many of you use different Bluetooth low energy devices today. But they will, of course, move into the smart home and smart building and things like that as well.